I mean, up to this point, the only application we've done is to take the semi-classical limit. And now I'd like to today give you an application that comes from statistical mechanics. So this is some summary stuff that I'll come back to. I'll cover it up here to start the main topic. So for simplicity, let's take a Hamiltonian, a one-dimensional Hamiltonian, kinetic plus potential, like this. Let's imagine that this is a system which is in contact with a heat bath, which is at a temperature T. And so we introduce the usual thermodynamic parameter beta, which is 1 over kT, where K is the Boltzmann constant. Then, as you know, the density operator is given by 1 over the partition function, C of beta, times T to minus beta H. And it's the normalization of the density operator leads to the condition that the partition function, Z of beta, is the trace of e to the minus beta h, like this. Now, let's take the density operator and let's compute its, let's write down its matrix element in the x representation between two x points, x0 and x. You can think of x0 as an initial and x as a final point. This is the same thing, obviously, as 1 over the partition function times the x-based matrix elements between x and x0 of the operator e to the minus beta h. This operator e to the minus beta h, by the way, let's give it a name. Let's call this the Boltzmann operator, just to have a name for it. I don't know if anybody else calls it that, but I think it's a reasonable name. In any case, what we've got here in this second factor is the matrix elements of the Boltzmann operator. Now, this is obviously similar to the matrix elements of the time evolution operator, which is e to the minus it h over h bar, sandwiched between x and x0. The Hamiltonian appears in the exponent in the same fashion. This, of course, is the propagator, which is what we've been talking about with path integrals. And in fact, these two matrix elements become identical if we make the formal substitution that the time is set to equal the minus I beta h bar. That is to say, we'll introduce an imaginary time. And if we do this, then the propagator goes over to the matrix elements of the Boltzmann operator. Now, I have no idea what the physical meaning of this is, this substitution, what it means to talk about imaginary time. But it's from a theoretical standpoint, it's certainly convenient because it allows you to convert one into the other and translate formulas. And in particular, propagator, the matrix elements of the propagator, time evolution operator, we have a path integral. And so this allows us to write down, just by making this change of variables or this substitution, allows us to write down the path integral for the matrix elements of the Boltzmann operator. So let me lift the board again to remind you. Here is our path integral in one dimension for the propagator. You see it's expressed in terms of this parameter epsilon. Here I'll remind you that epsilon is essentially a time increment. It's t divided by n. And if we take t and replace it by minus I h bar beta, then this becomes an imaginary increment like this. Let's write this as minus I eta, just so that eta becomes real. And let's re-express this propagator in terms of eta instead of epsilon, just to get rid of complex numbers. So one thing you can see is this prefactor is going to be real. It's going to be eta, I epsilon goes to eta. The I epsilon will go to eta here. The epsilon squared will go to minus eta squared there. Apart from that, it'll be the same formula. So to write that explicitly then, we have the matrix elements between x and x0 of the Boltzmann operator is now given by a path integral. It's the limit as n goes to infinity of a prefactor, which is the mass divided by 2 pi eta times h bar. Eta just is a Greek letter next to epsilon in the Greek alphabet. It's just supposed to represent a small quantity, just like epsilon does, n over 2. And then we have an integral. The x integration is the same as before. It's an integration over intermediate points. And then we've got an exponential. And instead of I epsilon over h bar, I epsilon is the same thing as eta, so it just turns into eta over h bar. So we have an integral exponential of the integral of eta divided by h bar. We have the sum j equals 0 to n minus 1 here. We've got m over 2 xj plus 1 minus xj, the increment in the x's, divided by epsilon squared, which turns into minus a squared. So I'll put a minus sign out front. Minus the potential energy evaluated in xj. That part doesn't change. And so we get this for a path integral for a matrix element of the Boltzmann operator. Simple substitution. Because of the introducing the imaginary time, the relative sign between what you might call the kinetic and potential energy has changed. It's now become both of the same signs. Let's take a minus sign out here and put the minus sign out front like this. And if you do this, you see that this exponential is now a real exponential. It's not oscillatory anymore. In fact, insofar as the kinetic, quote-unquote, kinetic energy term is concerned, it's really a Gaussian exponential in the variables x, which are the variables of integration. Of course, the potential energy can change
square.
That.
Yes.
Yes, squared, thank you. It should be squared. Yes, all right, so this is the integral. Now, as in the case of the Feynman path integral, this thermodynamic path integral in the exponent here has a sum which is formally of the same form as a Riemann sum, which looks like an approximation to an ordinary integral. And so if we use that to motivate notation, let's take this thing, everything except the h bar here, and let's write this out. This becomes in the limit when n goes to infinity, the eta goes to 0. In the case of the Feynman integral, remember we introduced this variable we call tau that ranged between 0 and the final time t. Let's let the variable in this modified integral be u instead of tau. It will go from 0 up to a maximum. What we'll do is we'll let u sub j be equal to j times eta. It's just the eta, it's just the j step in the stepping through the summation here. And then x of u sub j, you can think of as going over as x into x of u, just as a function x of u. Also, if we set j equals to n, we get u sub n, which is the last value of u, is equal to n times eta. That's the same thing as beta h bar. So u has a range between 0 and beta h bar. And thus this summation, which I circle here, turns into an integral. It's 0 to beta h bar of the quantity m over 2 dx du squared plus the potential energy v evaluated at x of u, and the whole thing integrated du. It turns into this integral like this. And what you see is that there's appearing here something which is, well, it's not the Lagrangian anymore because it's not kinetic minus potential, it's not kinetic plus potential. You could say this is the energy, that's the point one point of view. Another point of view is that this is still a Lagrangian, but it's in the Lagrangian of the inverted potential, that V has gone into minus V, turn the potential upside down. In any case, that's the integrand that appears in the exponent. And so this leads into a compact notation for this path integral, which is that there's first of all a normalization constant, which is kind of the limit of all this stuff here. And then we have an integral over a space of paths we call x and u. And the paths that we integrate over satisfy the condition that x of 0 is equal to x0, and that x of the upper limit, which is beta h bar, is equal to x, which is the final point. And then what we integrate is e to the exponential of minus 1 over h bar, an integral from 0 to beta h bar of this thing here. Let me just call this L inverted, L I and V, du, like this, to stand for the Lagrangian and the inverted potential where V went to minus V. Create the inverted potential. Or if you like, you can call this a Hamiltonian, I don't care. But in any case, this is the form or a compact notation for this path integral. All right. Now, this type of path integral has a real exponent instead of an oscillatory one. These real exponents are actually much easier to handle if you want to be mathematically rigorous. And they're actually called, it was given a name, they're called the Wiener integrals. The history of this is the Wiener integral is actually known well before the Feynman path integral. from the 1920s, having to do with statistical processes and so on. And it's also much easier to handle mathematically because it's a solitary case and more difficult. In any case, it's formally just an analytic continuation of a Feynman path integral into imaginary time. Now, let's put this to some use. Let's go back to the partition function, z of beta. This is, as mentioned, is the trace of the Boltzmann operator, e to the minus beta h. Now let's carry out the trace in the x representation. So it becomes the integral of over some variable x0 of x0 sandwiched around the Boltzmann operator. It's the sum of the diagonal elements, but we're doing this in a continuous representation. Well, plugging in for our path integral, this is the same thing as the integral over u of x0. And then for the diagonal matrix elements of the Boltzmann operator, I just take my formula here and just set the final x equal to x0. So there's this constant here, there's an integral over paths that go from x0 back to x0 again. Differential path in the quote unquote volume elemented path space. This d of x of u is really just an abbreviation for this limit of these integrations over the intermediate points on the path. And then we have, let's write it as e to the minus 1 over h bar, integral 0 to beta h bar, m over 2, dx du squared. Plus b of x of u, developing du. Okay, so there's an expression for the partition function. As you know, the partition function is oftentimes a central object of interest because if you can calculate it, then you can get equations of state and all kinds of other information about the system.
So x0 by x0?
Yes, because the x0s are the same on both sides. That came from taking the trace of the other thing. If we were really interested in the full matrix elements of the Boltzmann operator, the initial and final points wouldn't be the same. But this is an interesting thing because it means the paths, you know, the visualized paths are, they start at x0 and they wiggle around and who knows what. But whatever we know is when they, after an elapsed amount of time, quote unquote time, it isn't real time, it's this u time, but when it means beta h, the path returns to the initial point. So these are actually closed paths now. We're integrating only over closed paths with a given initial point. All right, now, this integral in this form can be subjected to a certain approximation. Let's take the case that the temperature T is large. This would mean that the thermodynamic parameter beta equals 1 over kT is small. And so that means upper limit of integration is small. So this path has to traverse its excursion in a small amount of elapsed quote-unquote time, beta h bar. Now that in turn means that the path cannot deviate very far from the initial conditions, because if it does, it had to cover a large amount of distance in a small amount of time. That means that the kinetic energy term here, this is all in quotes, kinetic energy, the kinetic energy term is large. Because of the minus sign here, it means it's going to damp up the integrand exponentially. So paths that make a large excursion in a short amount of quote-unquote time beta h bar don't contribute very much to the integral. And so this allows us to make an approximation where we take phi of x of u and just replace it by b of x0, which is the initial point. And so that simplifies the path integral, because the second term in the exponent here, we can now do the integral, from 0 to beta h bar of b of x0 du is just equal to beta h bar times b of x0. And we divide by h bar, and that will give us a factor here, as you can see, of e to the minus beta times b of x0. The factor that appears in the integrand here. However, this factor depends only on the initial point of the path. It does not otherwise depend on the path at all. And so this factor can be actually taken out of the entire path integral and inserted back here. Now, of course, it does depend on x0, so we can't bring it out that integral, but we can bring it out of the path integral. And so the result is that we get an approximation for the partition function, z of beta, is equal to integral dx0 of e to the minus beta v of x evaluated at x0 times our normalization constant times the integral of the path space x of u. These are still closed paths, x0 goes to x0. And then we get e to the minus 1 over h bar, integral 0 to beta h bar. And then we have just the kinetic energy term, m dx du squared over 2 du, like this. All right. Now this remaining path integral, the potential is gone away. And so this is a path integral for the free particle with no potential at all. And in fact, it's just an analytic continuation of the propagator for the free particle. Let me use u0 of t as the propagator for the free particle. The 0 means free here, free particle. It's just this thing evaluated between x0 and x0. Where we set beta, excuse me, where we set t is equal to minus ih bar beta. Well, here I summarize, we worked on the propagator for the free particle. Here it is, we did it in several different ways. And here it is. So this is for real time, but I want to first of all set x equals to x0. That's going to make the exponent go away, so this whole thing disappears. All that's left is the square root. And then setting t equals minus I h bar beta is going to make this into a real square root factor. It's going to be 2 pi h bar squared beta. So the result of this is that this entire path integral, free particle path integral, which I circled here, becomes very simply just the square root of m divided by 2 pi h bar squared beta. And so the result is, finally, is that we get the partition function. This is an approximation of the high temperature limit. Is equal to the square root of the mass m divided by 2 pi h bar squared beta times the integral over x0 of e to the minus beta times the potential of x0. And so this is a useful approximation in the high temperature limit. In STAT-MET courses, you always do free particles. You find a partition function for free particles or particles in a box. Carry this out explicitly. I'm sure you've done that. What this shows you is that it gives you a correction for the potential in case there's an interaction between the particles. I only did this for a 1D problem, but This would give you a correction for an external potential for a single particle moving in some potential. But by making a multi-particle system, the potential could be the potential of interactions amongst the particles. And this would give you corrections, for example, through the ideal gas law, to take into account attractions or repulsions between the molecules. This result is actually classical. It was known to Boltzmann probably in the 1880s, if not shortly thereafter. And the easiest way of deriving this is use classical statistical mechanics. However, that doesn't mean the path integral approach is useless because it's not just a hard way of doing an easy problem, because this whole approach here leaves open the possibility of making further corrections to this approximation here, where you take into account the finite deviations from the initial point. And if you do this, then you can obtain in effect, an expansion of the partition function in powers of beta. It becomes like a high temperature expansion with lower temperature corrections, quantum corrections coming into it. It's a more elaborate calculation. All right. That's all I want to say about path integrals. So, are there any questions about them? Yes.
Yes. In this equation in the box.
Yeah.
So the factor in front of the integral, that is like the quantum concentration. N cubed, that this.
Well, Boltzmann didn't know about h bar, so he didn't get the h bar here. That's certainly true. The 2 pi h bar is the size of a Planck cell in phase space. And in order to make classical statistical mechanics make some kind of sense, you've got to have
We've had to have some discretization of phase-space volume. People knew this even before quantum mechanics was around. But this is coming out with the correct normalization because it really is a quantum calculation. The essential part of it, though, is the integral of this exponential factor over the volume of the container, and that's the part that Boltzmann knew about. Okay, so now what I'd like to do is to turn to a new topic, which is that of charged particles in magnetic fields. We'll examine several cases of examples of the dynamics of charged particles in magnetic fields. And look at some of the issues which arise there. To begin with, I'd like to start with just some generalities about charged particles in magnetic fields. Let's say that Q is the charge. Let's speak about electromagnetic fields, which will allow to be completely general, time-dependent. In that case, the Hamiltonian is, as we've seen before, 1 over 2mp minus q over c, the vector potential, which in general depends on both position and time, 1 v squared, plus the charge q times the scalar potential, which I'll call capital Phi, as a function of x and t. We've discussed this before. This is not an holistic Hamiltonian, you'd like to spin. If we're doing classical mechanics, interpreting this as a classical Hamiltonian, then the x dot of the particle, which is of course the same as the velocity, is given by Hamilton's equations as dh dp. And that's the same thing as 1 over the mass times this vector p minus q over c a. If you're doing quantum mechanics, you may want to define the velocity operator x dot by the Heisenberg equations of motion, minus I over h bar, the commutator of x with a Hamiltonian. And if you work that out, you get the same answer. At least it's the same formula with the symbols reinterpreted as operators. So let's take both of these as motivation for defining what we call the velocity operator in quantum mechanics as being 1 over m times p minus q over ca. My point here is to introduce velocity operators. We can expect that these velocity operators correspond to the physical measurement of the velocity of the particle in the system. Now, these velocity operators, so let's explore the property of the velocity operators first of all. One thing to say is that if I just take this definition of the velocity operator and plug it into the Hamiltonian, I can eliminate this complicated p minus q over ca. And the result is the Hamiltonian looks like this. It becomes h is equal to m over 2 v plus q times the potential energy phi. And so what you see is that from a this makes the physical meaning of the Hamiltonian much more clear. It's just the kinetic plus potential energy. Or to say this another way, is this first term in this Hamiltonian is just a complicated way of writing the kinetic energy. When you have particles in magnetic fields, the kinetic energy is not p squared over 2m, it's this entire thing. Okay. All right, now let's look at the properties of the velocity operator. First of all, as far as the momentum operators are concerned, we know they commute with each other. But what about the velocity operators? Let's take, for example, the commutator of px with dy. Using this definition, this is just to work this out as 1 over m squared times the commutator of dx minus q over c ax with px minus q over c ax commutator with py minus q over c ay, like this. So there's four terms here, and 1 over m squared. So the commutator of px with py is 0. Commutator of px with the second term is going to be, first of all, minus q over c. Commutator of px with ay is minus I h bar, the derivative of ay with respect to x. Then take these cross terms. Commutator of the ax term with the py, again, is minus the factor of q over c. Commutator of ax with py is plus I over h bar, partial of ax with respect to y. And then finally, the commutator of ax with ay is 0, because the a's depend only on the x's. They're functions of the x's, and the x's commute. So writing this all out a little more carefully, it becomes I h bar q over n squared c times partial of ay with respect to x minus partial of ax with respect to y. And you see appearing here is the component of the magnetic field, which is B, magnetic field BZ. It's a Z component like this. The commutator of the X and Y components of the velocity is proportional to the Z component of the magnetic field. We can summarize these all together writing it this way as the commutator of VI with BJ is equal to IH bar Q divided by M squared C times epsilon IJK BK magnetic field. Right, so there's no vector potential is dropped out, and we have just the magnetic field appearing. We see that the velocity components don't commute if there's a magnetic field around, and thus it's impossible to find simultaneous eigenstates of the velocity in the presence of the magnetic field. It's also impossible to make simultaneous measurements with infinite precision of the different components of the velocity. If the magnetic field is zero, then of course that all changes, because then the velocity is proportional to the momentum of the commute, because the momentum of the components commute. While I'm writing down commutators, let me also mention the commutator of the x's with the velocities, xi with bj. These are easy because here's the definition of the velocity. The x commutes with a because a is a function of x, so it's only the p. So it's the usual xp commutator divided by m. So this is equal to I h bar divided by m times 1 under delta ij. Anyway, those are some commutation relations among interesting operators that occur in the All right. As I said, these are just generalities that apply to any problem involving a charged particle in a magnetic field in quantum mechanics. Next, I'd like to turn to a specific problem, which is that of a charged particle in a uniform magnetic field. This is quite important in practice and has lots of applications from astrophysics to condensed matter physics. Let's take the case in which the electric field is equal to zero, the magnetic field is equal to B times Z hat. Let's also take the case of an electron in which Q is equal to minus E. In contrast to Sakurai's book, I'm going to adopt the convention that E is always a positive number. It's a charge of a proton. I think it's less confusing to do that. Then I'll write Q for the charge of any old particle, which is minus E in the case of an electron. This is a quote-unquote spinless electron we'll talk about here. That's actually not too realistic, but we'll do it anyway because it's simpler to do it. So the first thing I'd like to do is to deal with the classical problem of the charged particle in the magnetic field. So let's do classical mechanics first. According to classical mechanics, the mass times the acceleration is the force, which is equal to the charge, which is minus E, times the velocity V over C crossed into the magnetic field. However, the magnetic field is the same as V times magnitude V times Z hat in the Z direction. And so dividing by the mass M, this becomes the acceleration is equal to the quantity EB over MC times the vector Z hat crossed into the velocity. Those are the equations of motion. The quantity EB over MC, as it turns out, has dimensions of frequency. So we give it a name here. We find omega is equal to EB over MC. And this is called the gyro frequency. And it's the frequency of the circular motion of the charged particle in the magnetic field. So just substituting in here for omega for that prefactor, if we write out the Newton's laws now in its three components, what you get is the x component of acceleration is minus omega times vy, the y component of acceleration is plus omega times vx, and the z component of acceleration is equal to zero. The z motion is particularly simple. You see, it gives you, it's just a free particle in the z direction, so z becomes equal to dz times t plus z naught. That's the solution in the z direction. And as far as the, so the only thing that remains is the x and y direction. It's a little bit harder, but not too much. Let's take these equations here, and let's integrate them once in time, both sides, the x and y equations. So we get dx on the left-hand side is equal to minus omega times y plus a constant I'll call cx. And then dy is equal to plus omega times x minus a constant I'll call cy. Cx and cy are just constants of integration. It's convenient to set cx is equal to minus omega times capital Y and set plus, and cy is equal to minus omega times capital X, where capital X and Y are new constants. We'll interpret these constants physically in a moment. But if we do this, then these velocity equations turn into, as you can see, they'll be vx, which is of course the same thing as x dot, is equal to minus omega of y minus capital Y, and dy, which is y dot, is equal to plus omega of x minus capital X. This now becomes the equations of motion. Let's introduce some new terminology. Let's write C is equal to X minus capital X, and let's write eta is equal to Y minus capital Y, the difference between the lowercase X and Y, which are the particle coordinates, and the capital X and Y, which are the constants of integration. If we do this, then you can see that C dot is equal to X dot, because capital X is a constant, and eta dot is equal to, is equal to Y dot, because capital Y is a constant. And so these equations of motion turn into this. They turn into C dot is equal to minus omega times eta, and eta dot is equal to plus omega times C. Simplifies them even further. And when these equations are easily solved, then you find that C of t and eta of t, the solution, is a function of time, is a matrix cosine omega t minus sine omega t, sine omega t, and cosine omega t, multiplied on to the initial condition t0 and eta 0. This matrix is a rotation in the xy plane that goes in the counterclockwise direction. So if you have a singular vector, C and A with two components, it just rotates in a circle in the counterclockwise direction. However, from these definitions of C and A, you've got X is equal to capital X plus C, and you've got Y is equal to capital Y plus C plus eta. And since capital X and Y are constants, it means that the particle position moves in a circle around a center whose coordinates are capital X and capital Y. And so if you plot the motion in the xy plane, it looks like this. But there's a certain point in the coordinates capital X and capital Y. There's a circle around this, if I can draw a circle very well, which I can't, but something like that. And if I have an initial condition here, X0, Y0, then the final condition is on the same circle, X of T, Y of T, like this. And the angle, which has been swept out, is omega T, as I said, it's in the counterclockwise direction. And so this gives us then not only the interpretation of these constants of motion X and Y, they're the center of the circle, but it also shows you that the motion in the XY plane is just a circular motion going around and around. This is for an electron with charge of minus E. If you've done it with a proton or positive charge, it'll be going in the other direction. It's kind of easier just to do it for one charge. And if you need the other charge, go back and redo the equations, because it'll change signs throughout everything. All right. If we combine this with the Z motion, which is that of a free particle moving in the Z direction, you can see that the motion of the particle is a helix through space. This helix can be viewed as there being a circle, which is parallel to the xy plane, which is moving through space with a constant velocity dz,
And as it does so, the particle is moving around and around with a uniform velocity around the circle, which itself is moving. And it's the center of that circle is called the guiding center. And so you can see that the guiding center traces out a line. It just follows the z motion, it's a straight line. And so the x and y coordinates are the coordinates of the x and y components of the guiding center. The guiding center, if I put in the z components, the guiding center is the point that has coordinates capital X, capital Y, and lowercase z. It's the same z as the particle, but the capital X and capital Y are the x and y variables. So capital X and capital Y are the guiding center coordinates. One further remark is that the guiding center coordinates were introduced as constants of integration. Here they are. And we can take these equations and solve for x and y as a function of the position of the particle and the velocity. And if we do this, what we get is a capital X is equal to lowercase x minus dy over omega. And we get capital Y is equal to lowercase y plus dx over omega. And this is all classical equations. Particle position x and y are both functions of time, and so is the particle velocity. But when you compute the right-hand sides, these functions of time conspire in such a way to make the left-hand sides independent of time. That's what you mean by a constant of motion. So if you just knew where the particle was at some point in its velocity, you could use this to figure out where the guiding center was against the circle. It could all be obtained from these equations. All right. That's all I want to say about the classical problem. Is there a question about that?
No, it looks like pencil drop. It was just starting to do so I was trying to like get over to it. Oh. And then I ended up putting it further away.
That's a perversity of Murphy's laws or something.
I know, that's the best way to can, right?
You're the genius. My daughter has one of these sticks, you know, that you squeeze a trigger and little thing on the end, you know, you have trash. She loves those things. You know? Okay, so that's the classical problem of a charged particle in a uniform magnetic field. And now let's work on the quantum problem. So let's write the Hamiltonian in terms of, first of all, in terms of velocity operators. It's just the kinetic energy m over 2 v squared. This is a quantum Hamiltonian now. You can, of course, split this up into what I'll call the perpendicular parts, perpendicular to the magnetic field, and then the parallel part, the kinetic energy that's parallel to the magnetic field, like this. We can call these two terms H perp and H parallel. We can do that. Now, the strategy that I'm going to pursue in solving this problem is to, first of all, work out the energy eigenvalues. Energy eigenvalues are physically measurable, and so they have to be gauge invariant. They have to be independent of any choice of gauge convention for the vector potential. On the other hand, as we've seen, wave functions do depend on the choice of vector potential because they change under a gauge transformation. So if you want to get the eigenfunctions, you have to commit yourself to a vector potential. So in the first step, we'll do the easier part, which is to find the energy eigenvalues. And we'll do this by working with operators. The basic strategy is to borrow definitions of operators from the classical solution. As far as the perpendicular motion is concerned, there's an obvious set of interesting operators. There's the particle positions x and y, the guiding center positions capital X and y, and the velocities vx and vy. These are the obvious ones. And as far as the perpendicular motion is concerned, it's z and vz, or perhaps pz if you want the momentum. We'll talk about velocity operators here. So we get this list of interesting operators. And so the name of the game here is just to x and y were defined classically up above, but we're going to borrow the definitions and convert them into operators. So the name of the game is just to explore the properties of these operators. Let's start with the velocity operators, vx and vy. And in particular, let's work out their commutators. Velocity operator, commutator, vx of dy. Well, that's a special case. Oh, gosh, I erased it. It's a special case of the commutator of the components of the velocity. In general, it would be I h bar q over n squared c times bz. But don't copy that down yet because I'm going to erase this. First of all, bz is just b for our problem because we're talking about a uniform magnetic field up at the top of the board there. And also, q is equal to minus e, so I get a minus sign with a charge e like this. And then we've got EV over MC is the frequency, so this is the same thing as minus I H bar divided by M omega. That's it, M omega. That's the way we'll write this. So let me put it in the same place, completely by itself. Vx dy is equal to minus I H bar over M omega. For other commutators, Vx with Vz and Vy with Vz are proportional to the x and y components of the magnetic field, which are zero in this case, so they commute. It's only the x and y velocity operators that don't commute. Now, maybe I'll mention the z and Vz next because they're particularly easy. The commutator of z with Vz. Vz is just the this is a position velocity commutator I spoke of before. This is IH bar divided by mass times 1. Yes?
Should the omega be on top?
Indeed it should. Thank you. That was going to make almost a little bit higher. I didn't fix it. Thank you very much. Yes, omega's on top, indeed. All right. Let's also compute the commutators of the guiding center positions, x and y. Let's do that. Well, here's, as I said, we're going to borrow the classical expression. So this is classically expresses the guiding center positions in terms of the particle positions and the particle velocities. Let's just borrow this and make it a definition of operators, capital X and capital Y, in the quantum problem. So if we do this, then I won't put hats on, at least not yet, but these are now operators. So this becomes the commutator of x minus dy over omega with y plus dx over omega. I'll do the calculation. There's four terms. There's first of all the commutator of x with y, which is zero. Then there's plus one over omega, the commutator of x with dx. Then there's minus 1 over omega, the commutator of dy with y. And then there's minus 1 over omega squared, the commutator of dy with dx. And we'll work up these terms. Commutator x with dx is ih bar over m, because vx is like p over m. So this is ih bar over m omega for the first term. For the second term, here's the commutator dy with y. That's the opposite order, so that's minus ih bar over m. Two minuses cancel. We get another factor of ih bar over m omega. And then the last term, we've got minus 1 over omega squared times the commutator of dy with dx. Well, here's dx with dy. You get dy with dx, which would change the sign, so it's plus ih bar omega over m. And you see one of these omegas upstairs cancels with one downstairs. We have two terms with a plus and one with a minus. The result is that it's IH bar over M omega. Let me summarize that over here on some table of commutators. X with Y is equal to IH bar divided by M omega. And so those are some commutators. Now, It's pretty clear that that all of the perpendicular operators are going to commute with all of the parallel operators because the perpendicular ones only involve x and y and px and py, and the parallel ones only involve z and dz. And it turns out I'm not actually going to need the particle position very much. It's these remaining four operators are interesting ones. If we compute the remaining commutators, such as x with bx and x with dy and capital Y with bx and dy, you'll find that all of those are zero. We'll leave it for you to do straightforward calculation just like I did. So what we can say for the commutators here is that all others are zero. All other commutators. Now let me erase this commutator calculation here because I don't need this anymore. There's the summary of it over there. The result of this is that by looking at variables of physical interest, which are suggested by the classical problem, we find what it's something which is almost what you call a canonical transformation. That is to say, we found new operators that almost satisfy the canonical commutation relations. These are Heisenberg-Born commutation relations. For ordinary x's and p's, these commutation relations are that xi pj is equal to ih bar delta ij, and that the x's and the x's commute with each other, and the p's commute with each other. These are the canonical or Heisenberg-Born commutation relations. And now what we've got is almost the same, except for proportionality constants, that's what we've got over here. The vx and the vy give a non-zero commutator, the x and the y give a non-zero commutator, the z and the vz give a non-zero commutator, and all the others are zero. So we can bring this out more clearly if I make some definitions here to get rid of the constants. Let's do this. Let's take, first of all, the guiding center position, capital X. The constant multiplying the IH bar is 1 over m omega here. So let me write capital X as 1 over the square root of m omega times the new operator called Q1. Capital Y is 1 over the square root of m omega times the new operator called P1. Then for the velocities, their commutator is, is IH bar times omega over m with a minus sign. So let's write Vy to be equal to the square root of, it's omega over m, right? Omega over m, square root of omega over m times Q2, and Vx is equal to the square root of omega over m times Q2. And then finally, let's write Z is equal to Q3, and let's write the velocity Vz is equal to capital P3 divided by the mass m, like this. Because if we make these definitions, then those commutation relations over there become the canonical commutation relations that I've written here, except I better write Q's and P's instead of X's and P's. So let me change them into what they are. They will be, first of all the Q's commute with each other, and all the P's commute with each other. But the Q, I, P, J commutator is equal to I, H, bar, delta, I, J. So in effect, there's a coordinate transformation that took us from the original X's and P's of the particle over to these variables that preserves the canonical commutation relations. Now, let's go back then and express the Hamiltonian in terms of these new operators. The perpendicular Hamiltonian is the perpendicular kinetic energy vx squared plus vy squared. As you see, the sum of these squared is going to be omega over m times q2 squared plus p2 squared. That's multiplied by m over 2. So what we get is, for the perpendicular part, you get omega over 2 times q2 squared plus p2 squared. And as far as the parallel part, we use the vz definition as p3 over m. And this turns into plus p3 squared over 2m. And this is the Hamiltonian now expressed in terms of these new variables. And you'll see for the perpendicular motion, it's a harmonic oscillator. And for the parallel motion, it's a free particle. And so, and again, I'll call this H perp and H parallel. And so you can write down the energy eigenvalues immediately. They're going to be n plus a half times H bar omega for the perpendicular energy. And then, since it's a free particle, it's just going to be P3 squared over 2m for the parallel kinetic energy. And this depends on two quantum numbers, n and PC3, as an energy. I really ought to be careful to distinguish the eigenvalue P3 from the operator P3, so let me put a hat on that here. I'll use my common notation of putting hats on operators when there's some danger of confusion with a corresponding C number or eigenvalue.
But in any case, this gives us the energy levels for the particle uniform magnetic field. These harmonic oscillator energy levels for the perpendicular motion are called Landau levels. And as you see, there's a minimum energy is 1/2 h bar omega in that perpendicular direction. P3 is, follows the usual rule for a one-dimensional free particle. It's the wind, but it's a momentum in the z direction that goes from minus infinity to plus infinity. Now, there's several remarks to make about these, this result. One of them is that this harmonic oscillator Hamiltonian doesn't quite look like the harmonic oscillators you're used to. They would look like this for a mechanical oscillator. It would be m, it would be a p squared over 2m plus m omega squared over 2x squared if I were going to use usual one-dimensional notation. The relation between that harmonic oscillator and this one, the answer is this. If I make a change of variables and write p is equal to the square root of m omega p prime and x is equal to x prime divided by the square root of m omega, this is again a canonical transformation. It preserves the commutation relations because it just squishes the x, squeezes the x, and stretches the p, but it's the same factor. Then you see this Hamiltonian above becomes equal to omega over 2 times x prime squared plus p prime squared. And so it takes on the same form that we see here. So by a simple change of variables, one harmonic oscillator is converted into the other. That's one remark. The second remark is, how did I know that these energy levels of this thing are given by the standard formula n plus 1/2 h bar omega? I didn't solve any Schrodinger equation. The answer is that we rely on the Dirac algebraic method for solving the harmonic oscillator, which, as you'll recall, involved the introduction of A's and A daggers and their commutation relations, and everything followed from that. But the commutation relations of the A's and A daggers followed from the commutation relations of the X's and the Q's and the P's, or the, now it's the X's and the P's. And since we've got canonical commutation relations here, the same argument applies exactly here. So Dirac's argument leads directly to this. It also, by the way, leads to expressions for the eigenstates in terms of products of creation operators acting in ground state. And then finally, here's a third remark about this. Is that this Hamiltonian is unusual because the Q1 and P1 variables, which are here, those are essentially the guiding center positions, x and y, do not appear in this Hamiltonian. So there's one entire degree of freedom. There's 3 degrees of freedom here, 1, 2, and 3, you can see. The number 1 degree of freedom is absent from the Hamiltonian. It's not that uncommon to find Hamiltonians that are independent of one of the Q's. So the momentum appears, free particle as an example. And if that happens, it means the momentum is conserved because the H is independent of Q. That's true in classical mechanics and also in quantum mechanics. But what we have here is more unusual because the Hamiltonian is independent not only of the Q but also of the P. The entire degree of freedom doesn't even occur. And what that means is that both X and Y are conserved. But that's just what we saw in the classical solution, is that x and y are constants of motion. But this is how it appears in the quantum context, is a sense of constants of motion. Both of them are constants of motion. Neither one of them appears in this Hamiltonian. All right. Well, the next stage, which I don't have time for, is to, which I'll do next time, is the energy eigenfunctions. So that's what we'll do next time. That's all. Yes?
Would these levels, I mean, when you talk about relative systems, you often have the levels,
yep.
Is that connected to the
That's the same thing. These are the levels.